Okay, we will have two readings this morning. The first one is from the prophet Jeremiah. It's chapter 31, verses 31 to 34. The time is coming, declares the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the people of Israel and Judah. It won't be like the covenant I made with their ancestors when I took them by the hand to lead them out of the land of Egypt. They broke that covenant with me, even though I was their husband, declares the Lord. No, this is the covenant that I will make with the people of Israel after that time, declares the Lord. I will put my instructions within them and engrave them on their hearts. I will be their God and they will be my people. They will no longer need to teach each other to say, "Know the Lord," because they will all know me, from the least of them to the greatest, declares the Lord. For I will forgive their wrongdoing and never again remember their sins. The gospel reading is from John chapter 12, verses 20 to 33. Some Greeks were among those who had come up to worship at the festival. They came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida in Galilee, and made a request. "Sir, we want to see Jesus." Philip told Andrew, and Andrew and Philip told Jesus. Jesus replied, "The time has come for the human one to be glorified. I assure you that unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it can only be a single seed. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. Those who love their lives will lose them, and those who hate their lives in this world will keep them forever. Whoever serves me must follow me. Wherever I am, there my servant will also be. My Father will honor whoever serves me. Now I am deeply troubled. What should I say? Father, save me from this time? No, for this is the reason I have come to this time. Father, glorify your name." This is the gospel of the Lord. Then a voice came from heaven, "I have glorified it, and I will glorify it again." The crowd standing there heard and said, "It's thunder." Others said, "An angel spoke to him." Jesus replied, "This voice wasn't for my benefit, but for yours. Now is the time for judgment of this world. Now the world's ruler will be thrown out. When I am lifted up from the earth, I will draw everyone to me." He said this to show how he was going to die. This is the gospel of the Lord. So the first part of that reading was about seeing. The Greeks, there were some Greeks, so in the Bible, that's like another term for foreigners, like they were not of Jesus's religion. They were foreigners who lived in Galilee. And they said, they came up to Philip and they said, "We would like to see Jesus." So you've got a flag whenever you're reading in the Bible and you see the word "see," that it's probably talking about something more than physically seeing something. Don't, in other words, don't take it literally. Don't. It is so limiting to read the Bible literally, because it does have a literal meaning. But that's just the beginning of it. My favorite teacher in college, Dr. Tyler, would always say, and he would say it with some fire in his voice, he would say, "The Bible doesn't mean what it says. It means what it means." Isn't it? So think about that. So when these guys are talking about they want to see Jesus, it's more than just, I don't think they meant that the disciples would have said, "Oh, there he is over there," and they could have gone, "Oh, fine." Maybe they wanted to follow. Maybe they wanted to understand him. Isn't that what we want, even right now, this morning? We want to see Jesus better. It's what we're trying to discover right now. You know who saw Jesus? Maybe we haven't talked about this much because he was in the Old Testament. How could someone in the Old Testament see Jesus? All right, well, Job saw him. Job saw. Look at the book of Job. And you have to do it patiently because it's 42 chapters. It'll take a while to read all through that. And notice, in all those chapters, God is mostly silent. It's mostly Job is talking. They're having a conversation to his friends. And Job is in pain and he is suffering. And it's getting worse. And his friends are not helping him. They're not soothing him any. In fact, they're pretty much saying, "Job, this is all your fault." Who needs a friend like that? So they're going back and forth and back and forth. And Job says, "I loathe my life. I loathe my life. I will say to God, do you have eyes like me? Do you see like humans see? Why do you let me suffer like this if you can see me?" So this is what Job is saying. And God doesn't answer him. And he goes on, and they're going on like this. Finally, at the end, we're talking about right now like chapter 39 or something like that. And God finally answers, and he answers out of the whirlwind. Like it's not a gentle, it's not this kind of a soothing voice that a parent might have to their hurt child. God says, "You talk without understanding." That's the first thing God says to him. He's the dying. Poor guy is like dying. And God says, "You talk without understanding. What are you gonna do? Haul me to court and press charges?" This is God's answer to Job out of the whirlwind. And Job is shaken. And he says, "Forgive me. Forgive me. I talked too much. I will listen now." That is probably one of the great spiritual breakthroughs in our life, when we get to that point when we're in conversation with God and we say, all right, I'm going to keep quiet now and I'm going to listen. How long does that take to reach that point? So this is what Job says. And God kept interrogating him for two chapters, and Job is just sitting there kind of stunned. And he's asking him all these impossible questions. And Job sits there, and then God stops. And Job says, I have talked about things that I didn't understand. They were too wonderful for me to grasp. I did not know what I was talking about. And then Job said, I had heard of you, God, by the hearing of the ear, but now my eye sees you, and I am ashamed, and I repent. And at that moment, it was like Job died. The Job that was talking to his friends, that Job was dead now. And there's a different Job sitting there. And as he see, it's a Job who sees something is different. And he's not just talking about seeing with his physical eyes. He sees a larger picture. I wonder, does that happen to us? Remember, at the beginning of our reading, the Greeks were going up to Philip and they're saying, we would like to see Jesus. Does that kind of seeing happen to us, where suddenly the world is much larger than we thought it was? There are levels of reality and consciousness. There's so much more to see. Does that seeing even change us into Christ? Do we become Christ the longer we live and the more that we see? Do we actually become reflections of Jesus Christ? The Gospel of Matthew says in chapter 25 that we probably see Jesus every day and don't even know it. We don't realize what we're looking at. It says every time we make a gesture of kindness toward somebody, every time someone says they're thirsty and we bring them something to drink, we are bringing that drink to Jesus Christ. That's what Matthew is telling us. Every time we are kind towards another person, we are being kind to Jesus. We are seeing him. So, thinking about seeing Jesus in our daily encounters, which, by the way, right after our church service this morning, like between 11 and 12 o'clock, I saw it happening last week. There were some of the children, some of the youth from the church, and they were baking Irish soda bread to give away. And they were standing in front of the church receiving these Lenten cake kits that I was announcing. And every person that drove up carrying one of these bags and bringing out cake and whatever, icing, some people just brought oil. Every one of these was an encounter with Jesus. It happens all the time. I wonder sometimes, we used to talk about this in seminary, what color was Jesus? What skin color was he? Because if you look at artwork, he's been painted white. Jesus looks very Caucasian in many, many pictures. We've got a picture in the parish house of Jesus. He looks like I did about 20 years ago. Or I've seen pictures of Jesus where he's black. He's got dark skin. I've seen Asian looking Jesus. What color was Jesus? And like if we were to see him today, who would he come to us as? Could Jesus be Asian? I read an article, it was last summer, that a dermatologist wrote. He lived in Tampa, Florida. And listen to what this dermatologist said. He said, the epidermis, the layer of our skin here, the epidermis is very thin. It's a thin layer of our outer skin. And it is only, how thick is our skin? Do you know? According to the dermatologist, the medical expert, it's only 1 millimeter thick. I was measuring that yesterday while I was writing this, just to get an idea. It's like a credit card. That's, our skin is about as thick as our credit card, our Visa card. It's very thin. And then he says, but it contains one of the few things that seems to justify millennia of oppression between human beings. And that element that it contains is pigmentation. It contains pigmentation. Were it not for this tiny layer of our skin, we'd all look alike. So at its core, he writes, racism is bigotry against the epidermis. This is where our bigotry is aimed at, the epidermis of other people. And yet, this minute human difference was enough for many of our nation's historical leaders to enable beliefs in racial superiority. Just by this tiny 1 millimeter thick difference between us, we have groups of human beings who think they are better because they have a different pigment in their skin. It's crazy when you think of it like that, isn't it? That this is why there's so much hatred, because of 1 millimeter of skin? We have just experienced another mass shooting where 8 people were murdered and 6 of them were women of Asian descent. In all of the 8, 7 of them were women. The 21-year-old alleged shooter, his name is Robert Aaron Long, was reportedly an active youth group member of the Crabapple First Baptist Church, which is about 40 miles from Atlanta. Right now in our country, we are having a debate about whether we can call these shootings a hate crime. Were they a hate crime against Asian Americans? Because eight of them, because six of the eight were Asian women, were they? And some people protest and say, no, don't try to bring that into it. But in the last year, since this pandemic started, just 1 year, hate crimes against people of Asian descent have risen 150%. And in that same time, all other hate crimes have decreased, like 7%, because there's much less social interaction. There's less opportunities to do hate. Because everyone's inside, right? And yet, in this time, hate crimes against people of Asian descent have risen 150%. Why is that? Why is that? Well, the virus, as far as we know, was first reported in Wuhan, China. And then people said, well, it's Chinese. It's a Chinese. Now, all of these 500,000 plus deaths in our country, it's the Chinese fault. They all did. This is what people are saying. Some of our national leaders have called this the China virus or the Kung flu. People in the highest offices were saying that. Our previous president said that all the time. He's on the news, so many news clips of him saying this, as if a virus has a nationality, as if it has a race. As if a virus belonged to a certain political party. This is so crazy. But this is how hate speech works. We take a catastrophe like a pandemic and we blame someone for that. We blame another nationality. We call it by that name. Do you realize how much hate speech we see used towards Jesus in the Gospels? They used, the leaders were doing it then. It is very effective. Jesus was called demonic. He was called Beelzebul. He was called insane. Jesus was called a blasphemer and a heretic. That was how the leaders of his day justified killing him, and they had the crowd's support. Remember, the crowds were saying, crucify him, crucify him. Why? Well, because he's Beelzebul. He's demonic. But look at what Jeremiah tells us this morning. He says that underneath are 1 inch, no, no, are 1 millimeter thick surface of epidermis. We are all exactly the same, created in God's image. Jeremiah said that every one of us, every human being that you look at, has God's law engraved on their hearts. Every one of us, no matter what we look like outside and no matter how much hate we might be spewing in our lives, the deeper you go, we are divine, said Jeremiah. God is engraved in our hearts. The more that we pray to God to open our eyes and see the beyond the surface, to see deeper and deeper into others, we not only see the divine image in them, we become that divine image ourselves. God said, they will no longer need to talk about me, God said, because they will all know me. And what does it mean to know God in the Bible? It means that we begin expressing the life of God in our own lives, and we don't even think about it. All we need is some patience and trust, like Job had. Let us pray. Dear God, help us to see. Help us to see Jesus the way that Job saw you and he was reborn. Let your image, which is deep within us, come more and more to the surface so that your love may flow through our lives. We offer our prayers in your name, Jesus, for you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Thank you to everyone who was able to continue with their pledges and offerings. And thank you to all of you who are bringing the ingredients for the cake gifts that we will be giving soon. Let us offer a prayer right now together for these offerings. O Lord, may your work continue through these gifts and through our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. Our closing hymn is Here I Am, Lord. I, the Lord of sea and sky, I have heard my people cry, all who dwell in dark and sin, my hand will save. I who made the stars of night, I will make their darkness bright. Who will bear my light to them? Whom shall I send? Here I am, Lord. Is it I, Lord? I have heard you calling in the night. I will go, Lord, if you lead me. I will hold your people in my heart. I, the Lord of snow and rain, I have borne my people's pain. I have wept for love of them. They turn away. I will break their hearts of stone. Give them hearts for love alone. I will speak my word to them. Whom shall I send? Here I am, Lord. Is it I, Lord? I have heard you calling in the night. I will go, Lord, if you lead me. I will hold your people in my heart. I, the Lord of wind and rain, I will tend the poor and lame. I will set a feast for them. My hand will save. Finest bread I will provide, till their hearts be satisfied. I will give my life to them. Whom shall I send? Here I am, Lord. Is it I, Lord? I have heard you calling in the night. I will go, Lord, if you lead me. I will hold your people in my heart. I will hold your people in my heart. Let us go forth now into this first Sunday of spring, beautiful spring day, filled with the light and the love and the forgiveness and the patience of Jesus Christ, so that we may share these gifts wherever God sends us. Amen. Have a wonderful day. Keep wearing your masks when you go out. I hope many of you are able to get your vaccinations. I got my second one last week. Hopefully we will begin to see one another in this place. In the meantime, know that I continue to pray for you. I love each of you, and I hope to see you next week.